Well, good evening, everyone. Good to see you in house tonight, and those of you joining us online tonight as well, we welcome you and thank you for taking time out here in the midweek to look into God's Word and spend time in prayer. We invite you, of course, to be with us on Sunday. Sunday school at 10 o'clock, small group Bible study time, and then our worship service at 11, and of course on Sunday evening at 6:30. Let's go to the Lord in prayer, asking you to bless our time together tonight. Precious Lord, we thank you for all of your abundant goodness upon us. And Lord, we ask that you would continue to watch over us. Be with us tonight, Lord, as we have entered into this service. We ask for your presence. We ask, Lord, for the Holy Spirit to speak to us in a very rich and real way. When we leave here, we know that we have been with you. God, I ask your blessings upon each person here, many others, Lord, who would love to be in your house tonight who are unable. We ask, God, that you would be with them. And God, may you be glorified in all that is said and done tonight. And we ask these things in the precious and holy name of our Savior, Redeemer, and friend, Jesus Christ. And all of his children said together, amen. Brother Brandon, come and lead us.
Evening, everyone. Get out of that cool, out of the heat and into the cool, coolness of God's house. If you will, let us stand. We'll sing our hymn for tonight. It is 474, All the Way My Savior Leads Me. And we'll sing all three verses.
Well, again, let me express my gratitude unto the Lord for giving us this time tonight and for you for coming, joining us. Also, those of you online, we invite you to comment. Love to read the comments and sometimes respond when necessary, and also encourage you to share this that others will be able to be encouraged by the word of the Lord tonight. We're going back to Hebrews chapter 4. And we've been in 14, 15, 16 a couple times with the thought of finding hope and happiness in the heart of Christ. And tonight, as we read, I'm going to go back and read 14 through 16 in chapter 4 of Hebrews, and then we're going to go right into chapter 5 and read through verse 5. Our key verse tonight will be chapter 5 and verse 2. As we consider the thought tonight, Jesus is gentle with us. I begin reading again in Hebrews chapter 4, and I start in verse 14. Since then we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. For every high priest chosen from among men is appointed to act on behalf of men in relation to God, to offer gifts and sacrifices for sin. He can deal gently with the ignorant and wayward, since he himself is beset with weakness. Because of this, he is obligated to offer sacrifice for his own sins, just as he does for those of the people. And no one takes this honor for himself, but only when called by God, just as Aaron was. So also, Christ did not exalt himself to be made a high priest, but was appointed by him who said to him, "You are my son, today I have begotten you." May God bless the reading of his word this evening. Amen. You know, it's always appreciated in our daily dealings, in our business dealings. It's appreciated when people deal gently with us as fellow human beings. Too often, people, and that includes us, we want to be treated a certain way, but that doesn't mean they always treat others in the way that they desire to be treated. And there's a reason that Jesus spoke on that very thought in what we call the golden rule there in the Sermon on the Mount. There are also times that it can be too easy for any of us, if we allow ourselves to be, to forget our weaknesses and sins when we might be judging someone else's weaknesses with our words or even with our deeds. Sometimes we don't deal as gently as we should. I haven't always. I failed in that as well. We say things like, "I wouldn't do that." But there's some things we would do, and there's many things we have done. So we need to be careful and deal gently with other people and their weaknesses. Well, under the old covenant, the high priest was chosen by God and also from among their brothers. As the writer of Hebrews reminds us, they should have dealt gently with people because they were men like all mankind and able to relate to them. I'm sure many did. I'm sure many did a wonderful job of representing the people in relation to God the Father. But not all did, and we know that. We know that. If you're looking for a wrong example of the priesthood, you need look no further than 1 Samuel and be reminded of Samuel's sons. God began the priesthood. It was his idea. It wasn't mankind's idea, it was his idea. And he did so that they would set aside for the office certain men, again, to act on man's behalf before God. Now, why did God do that? God did that because man in himself could not approach God upon his own because of his unholiness. I want to say that has not changed. Now, I know we often say that we no longer need a priest to go to God. That's not true. We do. We do need a priest to go to God, and that's where Jesus comes in. He is the great high priest, called of God, raised up and given that position to be our great high priest. The writer of Hebrews is telling us why Jesus is not only now the one and only true high priest, but also the writer of Hebrews is telling us why he is a better high priest than all of the men that served the priesthood before him. Jesus has passed through the heavens and he's taken his seat as our high priest at the right hand of God the Father. And God the Father, again, is the one that chose him, and he has given Jesus Christ the name that is above all other names. He is the one that has established Jesus as the great high priest. Now, last week we looked at how this Jesus, our high priest, sympathizes with us and our weaknesses. And in and through Jesus Christ, we find grace and we find mercy to help in time of need. Or as we looked at in verse 15 of chapter 4, that can actually mean in the Greek, in the nick of time, right in the nick of time, through Jesus, we find grace and mercy that is needed. We know, as the writer of Hebrews wrote, and also through other scripture, that Jesus is without sin. And as all other high priests should have done, Jesus deals gently with the wayward and ignorant, and he acts on our behalf before God. I'm glad of that tonight. I'm glad that Jesus deals gently with the wayward and ignorant. I'll tell you why I'm glad of that is because I have a tendency to stray. I have a tendency to be ignorant. Anybody else there tonight? Amen. We all have, and we'll do that from time to time. I think of the words in that precious hymn, how our heart is prone to wonder. And it is. And so I'm thankful that Jesus Christ is a high priest that deals gently with us. In chapter 5 and verse 2, as I read, the ESV states, he can deal gently. The Greek wording essentially means that the high priest can curb his emotions. That's what that Greek word means. It can curb his emotions, and meaning that the high priest doesn't act to one extreme or to the other extreme with the ignorant and wayward. He doesn't, in other words, the high priest doesn't allow his personal feelings of anger or disgust or impatience to get in the way of him serving on mankind's behalf before God. Jesus fulfills this office perfectly. He is able to curb his emotions and not deal with us, one, as we deserve. He is a balance between law and love. Jesus perfectly balances law and love. Truth is, we've all had people that we grow weary of, especially when we've tried to help time and time again, and they have continued to move away from the Lord and make ignorant decisions. At times we've been impatient, and we show disgust sometimes toward others. At times, I've not been able to curb my emotions, but the high priest Jesus can. Jesus can, and he does. Under the old covenant, the high priest could do that with those that came to him, or they were supposed to do that. And like I said, I think many times they did. There were many good high priests and priests in the priesthood. Among the Levites, but they were supposed to be able to do that very thing and to deal gently with the people because they too were afflicted with human weakness. The temptations of life the tests in life, the toils in life, the trials of life. They understood because they were human and living on the same earth as those they were supposed to serve. The word weakness here, we looked a little bit at that last week, I believe, but the word weakness here includes a moral weakness that mankind has. And the terms wayward and ignorant can deal both with unintentional sin, but also willful sin. Dane Ortlund wrote, dealing with this verse, the idea here in chapter 5, verse 2, is that Jesus does not throw up his hands in the air when he engages sinners. He is calm, tender, soothing, restrained. He deals with us gently. Again, the writer of Hebrews is showing us how Jesus is higher than the angels, how he is greater than Moses, and that he is now the great high priest in heaven, and he is greater than the Old Testament Levitical priesthood. Now, as we think about Jesus dealing gently with the wayward and ignorant, it's important to remember who it is that Jesus deals gently with. Who does Jesus deal gently with? Well, he deals gently with those sinners that come to him with their sin. To those who come to him with their sin and who are repentant of their sin. To Jesus, there is no sin so heinous that he cannot forgive and help them overcome. But there's the key. They come to him with faith. It's not that Jesus overlooks the sin of the world. It's not that at all. It's that he cleanses those who genuinely come to him with faith and a desire to overcome their waywardness and to overcome and get the victory over ignorance. Everybody's going to experience Jesus. Everybody, everyone will experience Jesus in one of two ways. You will either experience his grace, his mercy, his compassion, and his gentleness, or you'll experience his judgment. There is no neutral state. One is just as clear as the other throughout the pages of Scripture. But it's not God's will that any would perish without knowing Jesus Christ as their Savior. You either come to him as your high priest, or you attempt to be your own high priest. And believe it or not, that's what probably the far vast majority attempt to do. They try to be their own high priest, trying to represent themselves before God, and can't do that. To those who come to him, Jesus gets down with us on our level. I don't mean that he wallows in the filth with us, but he is there with us even as we have become dirty and wayward at times. Does so without sin. He gives us what we need. Jesus helps us deal with our ignorance. He helps us deal with our waywardness. He helps us deal with our weaknesses if we let him. Now remember, as we discussed last week, this is why he came. So showing gentleness with compassion for our weaknesses is natural to him. It's who he is. It is his very heart for sinners. Jesus is the greater high priest for two reasons. One, he shows no bias among sinners, and he was himself without sin. Two, he does not have to make a sacrifice for his sin, his own sin, like the old covenant priesthood did. We understand that Jesus himself has become that sacrifice, the sacrifice for our sin, and he is continually before God in heaven. And at the same time, it is amazing, still, the gospel still amazes us that he came to us. and he put on our flesh and bone, and he got down with us in this troublesome world. Therefore, even though sinless, when we come to him, when we come to Jesus Christ, he is able to show compassion and gentleness towards us in our moral, in our intellectual, and in our physical weaknesses, even in our ignorance and our waywardness. And so the question is not, can Jesus deal with my waywardness and ignorance? That's really not the question, even though that's one many people can't get over. They think there's no way Jesus will accept me. Some people have that barrier. I'm too filthy. I'm too gross. I must disgust Jesus Christ. The question is not, can Jesus deal with my waywardness and my ignorance? The question is not, can Jesus or would Jesus show compassion, and would he deal with me gently in my waywardness and ignorance? That's not the question either. The question to answer is this: what do I do with my weaknesses, my waywardness, and my ignorance? Is Jesus my only hope? Do I take my ignorant decisions and my waywardness and my weaknesses, do I take them to Jesus with faith and repentance, asking for his grace and mercy? That is the question to answer. What I do with my sin and what I do with the great high priest that God has established to be there on my behalf, on your behalf. That's the question that we all have to answer. What do I do with my waywardness? Do I take it to Jesus? Ask his forgiveness and his cleansing and his strength to give us the victory over it. Do we turn? The word repentance means, do we turn to Jesus with faith, gladness, and joy? The question is, what do I do with the great high priest? My prayer is that you believe that Jesus Christ is your only hope, and that he stands before God as your advocate, as your representative. And so that's the real question. Have I, do I, will I make Jesus my advocate and representative in the heavens? To all that choose Jesus, he deals gently with us. Yes, it's true. There are times, decisions we've made, we still have to bear the consequences on this side of heaven through choices we've made. But we can be forgiven in heaven, cleansed, made new, and start afresh in our life. The prophet spoke these words in Matthew, brought them back out in Matthew chapter 12 and verse 20, a prophecy speaking of the Messiah. And I love this. It's so encouraging. A bruised reed he will not break. A bruised reed he will not break, and a smoldering wick he will not quench until he brings justice to victory. He deals so much more gently with us than we deserve. Truth is, Jesus did not come to crush us, but that we might know life, because we've already been crushed under the weight of sin and pain and hurt. If you come to him with trueness and trust, you will find that Jesus will always deal gently with you. The world won't always do that. Amen. Even sometimes, as I said before, I don't do it. Even sometimes when I should, it's grieved me. And yes, as I said, sometimes there are still consequences to deal with because of our poor choices. But thank God, Jesus will still deal gently with those that come to him.
What a wonderful high priest God has set in the heavens for us to go through. What a wonderful representative on our behalf. What a gentle Savior. And so as we come to a close of this study tonight, just a reminder, we must always look to Jesus. He is compassionate towards those who come to Him. This is His heart. It's who He is. And because of that, each one of us can find hope and happiness in the healing heart of Jesus Christ. Amen. Lord, I pray for those that might be wayward to some degree tonight, and we all are prone to wander. God, keep us close to You. May Your Holy Spirit guide us. Help us, O Lord, to hide Your word deep in our heart that we might not sin against You. Heavenly Father, we thank You for the compassion that You have had upon wayward, rebellious people that we are. Have mercy upon us, O Lord. You are our only hope. And if there be one that has forgotten how much You love them, how gently You will deal with them, and the compassion that You will show towards them, draw them, Lord, into the table of grace tonight. Remind each person under the sound of My voice that there is hope and healing in Your very heart. Bring healing to our lives tonight, O Lord, morally, intellectually, physically, because You know our weaknesses even more than we know ourselves. We ask these things, O Lord, with faith, hope, and joy in Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, for those of you online, we thank you so much for joining us tonight. May the Lord be with you. If at all possible, we'd love to see you with us in church on Sunday morning, Sunday school at 10 o'clock a.m. We have a class for everyone, and then Sunday morning worship at 11 and Sunday evening services at 6:30 p.m. May God be with you. Bye-bye.